Right.
All the good things we do, yeah? All right, good morning, everybody. This is Nousheen Mukhtar, and you're watching the Business Excellence Show with my dear friend, Flemming Rontved. And today we are going to talk about winning, winning, winning. Are you ready to join? If you are, drop in the comments where you are watching us from, what do you do, and how we can help you in winning. So, I don't need to introduce Flemming because everybody knows him by now.
Yes, today
he is the excellent business mentor.
Yeah, and I'm actually feeling I'm winning right now. Actually, a lot of things is happening in my life. I didn't know if I introduced, I said it to you, but I don't know if I introduced it to the audience. We're actually working with an emirate of establishing a human academy where we're actually working with, what you can say, the brain. That's where we need to be all the time, and not all the time, but we need to be aware of how does our brain work, the epicenter of performance. How can we set up ourselves to win? In the moment, I know how I can set up myself to win, and I'm a leader or a manager, I will also know how to set up employees for the win. And I'm just the translator of the strategies from strategic department or the CEO or the boardrooms. I'm the translator, and I need to focus on the planning, the organizing, the communication, and the monitoring. Not controlling, monitoring.
Monitoring.
And that's a very big difference. And if I can't do that, I will set people up to fail every single day. And people don't like that. Is that right or
nobody
wrong?
Likes it.
No,
nobody
we want
likes
to
it.
Win. Is that right? We want to win. So how can we do that? What are we going to talk about today? We know that our brain can process a large amount of information. It has real talent for forming patterns and connection. We also know that our brain wants to prove ourselves right. And that's actually sometimes a problem and sometimes a good thing. So what we will focus on today is avoid getting blinded by your own data, your comfort zone, making better management and leadership decision. And one of the most important part we need to learn is to slow down to go fast and get it right the first time. What does that mean?
Getting it right the first time. We want a lot of detail on this. Like, getting it right the first time is not something that everybody wins at. It's not something that happens all the time. And there is always a first time. So let's start from this one. What do you say?
So what I said is slow down to get it right the first time. What I said is if I'm jumping a little bit back, determine and stay clear on the goals. What are the goals? Do you know the goals? What I'm saying right here is that we have a tendency, we have our comfort zone. Is that right? You have a comfort zone.
Yes.
Good.
Everybody has
Yes. That's the navigator. That's the perception. That's how we are engaging every single day through our five senses. But all our five senses are colored by the comfort zone. The other part is our brain only comprehends 10% of what's going on around us.
Yes.
So are we focusing on the right data?
Mm-hmm.
Do we have the right data?
We always have the right data. The key is to focus on it.
What?
I'm saying that we always have the right data with us, and our mind keeps on processing it. Sometimes it triggers reminders to us, look, focus on the right one. Don't look at the wrong things.
I will tell you, do you always have the right data? Why am I asking you that question? If you go back in my sentence, I was talking about comfort zone too. So what am I actually talking about? What am I talking about here? I'm actually talking about this thing that our brain tells us all the time what to look at. So what we actually need to do is starting bursting our bubbles.
Okay.
We only see what we want to see according to our comfort zone. We don't believe. If I'm looking out, I'm seeing a lot of things, but I'm only seeing the things that's relating to my comfort zone. We may not believe and we do not pay attention to all the other things we're seeing. Can you follow what I'm saying now?
Yes, absolutely. I got that.
So our bodies.
What I feel is we have to consciously pull ourselves out of the comfort zone and try to understand and pick and choose the right data that provides us the right kind of answers for winning.
Yes, because our bubbles are powerful. Our beliefs are the truth. We talked about beliefs earlier. Believe it and you'll receive it. But if you don't believe it, don't do it because it's only a waste of time. So exactly. Our beliefs are truth. That's what's going on in our brain. Our beliefs and truth are based on real data. And that's where the problem comes, because the data we select are the real data. So the data our subconscious select becomes the real data, but they may not be the real data. You can be in a perfectly healthy environment, but your translator, navigator, comfort zone tells you it's toxic. And, and can you follow what I'm saying now?
Yes.
So what we need to do is bust the burbles, bust the bubbles.
Okay.
And we need to slow down to move forward, to make the right decisions. What I will talk about here is the ladder of interference.
Yes.
You can Google it, the ladder of interference. So the ladder of interference, I will introduce to you, because this is actually very important. So how do we make decisions, you can say? How are we going to do that? We actually observe data. So we observe the data, we select data, we add meaning to that according to our programming, according to the way we are brought up. We make assumptions according, you can say, we make assumptions. We have a lot of assumptions. We have a lot of beliefs, if you can understand what I'm saying. So if I'm a leader, I may go into the room and say, we have this problem, this challenge, and I already got the solutions according to my assumptions. So we're moving this way.
Okay.
What happened now? Did you slow down? No.
Yes, because... No, what I feel is that if people are going to go through the ladder, let me say it that way, and have the process and the steps of starting from observation and consciously selecting the data and then adding meaning to the data and making associations that answer what goes on in his mind and also answers his needs and leading up towards assumptions where the meanings are... more relevant to their immediate reality, let me say it that way, and then reaching a conclusion. The entire process will not happen just in a jiffy. It will take a little bit of time for a person to regulate his mind to continue with the process and continue repeating the same process. What do you say?
The thing is that you're not even aware of you're repeating the process because you're not paying attention to life, because it's subconscious automated thinking, automated doing. I experience and observe data as a video camera captures data. I hear words, observe body language, and collect information according to my programming, according to my perception, according to my navigator. So it's only according, since I can only comprehend 10%, my brain only can do that, we are missing a lot of stuff. I select data that I feel is relevant. I feel, again, now we got feelings and emotions, I feel is relevant, and discharge data that seems irrelevant. Again, my data collection is only according to my programming, my comfort zone. I add meaning based on what I feel is reasonable according to the data I selected. I make assumptions that my data and meaning are accurate and represent reality. It may not, but that's my assumption. I draw conclusion based on my assumptions and based on what is best for me and those I care for. I adopt belief based on my conclusions as if everyone has the same conclusions and beliefs. Is that right?
Right.
Because I draw or I adopt beliefs based on the conclusions I made as if everyone has the same conclusions and beliefs. But is that, that's not true, is it?
That's not true. I was about to say this. The thing is that there are two points I want to make. First thing, let me start from here where you are saying that everybody may have same beliefs and same interpretations. No, that is not possible because our individualities, our background, our feelings, our past experiences, our understanding of the world, everything intervenes into the level of interpretation we bring to the assumptions that we are making and the conclusions we are drawing from observations, and that happens within the ladder of inference. Now, the point is, second one, I'm jumping towards that, individuality is one thing that differentiates the beliefs that we will incur or we will form as a result of observations and our experiences and whatever we are thinking, where our brain is in control of what we are thinking and we are going to do next. Yes. Now, the thing is that individuality is there. And hence, everybody is not a winner. When we are consciously trying and programming our brains to make wins possible.
Yes.
How different we are at that point in time from everybody else. Does that matter? Does that affect the level of winning we get?
It does, because I act based on my beliefs as they were proven facts. I act based on my beliefs as they were proven facts. And I adjust new data to fit my beliefs. Can you follow what we are saying right here, right now? So if you want to set your brain up to win, you need to, or what can you do? You need to develop awareness and understanding of, you can say, this ladder we've been talking about. As I said, you can just Google it. You need to suspend the process. You need to step out of the process. That means you need to stop. You need to pause. At each, you can say, step and ask yourself questions. What if I'm wrong? There's something else. It could be interpreted another way. There's more I know. Do not know about this, or things has changed, especially here right now. I had a business 1 year ago. Now we got the COVID-19. My business is totally changed. My business, personal business, is totally changed. Everything I do today is virtual. It's not. Before it was physical, but today it's virtual. And since it's virtual, I'm changing everything in my business. I'm going virtual. I can reach the whole world. Before I only could reach in UAE. Now I can reach the whole world. That would change my marketing. Yes. I need to reach to the whole world.
This shift has also changed what people expect of you, what you expect of people who work with you, people who watch you, people who benefit from your thoughts and your ideas. It has also changed the way people are going to make business with you, the business interaction.
It has changed everything. It has. You can say that social media marketing is the most important part in the world today. And when you do social media marketing, you need to step out of the crowd. For me, there is, you can say, I think of myself an expert in the field. So how do I tell people that? And I'm the expert. Because if I go for LinkedIn, if I go for Facebook, there is 1 million people who may have the same message as I have. So I need to make a message that's touching people's emotions that let me step out of the crowd. This is my marketing, which needs to be totally changed. 1 year ago, I was not doing social media marketing at all. Today is one of the most important parts to reach the audience. So this is how my business has changed. If I do not stop and pause and focus, you can say, ask myself the questions and start focusing on, you can say, if I want to look at this, I need to be focused on the target. What does winning look like for me today? For the current scenario, for my product, for my services, the project. How do I communicate that win to my team? Mm-hmm. How do we set up our company, the single employee, for the win?
Yes, absolutely.
How do we do that? How do we communicate from the strategic department? How do I, as a leader, communicate to my team? How you can say, one of the things you can do is use what I call presumptive language, future active past tense questions to focus your brain, like you already did it. Your brain can't comprehend or see the difference between imagined and reality. So if you already imagined that you've done a thing and you as a person speak as you already did it, what does happen? What happens here? Can you give me the answer? If you do that.
When you do that, you have already changed the way you were communicating before. And that change is now answering the way people are expecting you to do now.
You communicate as you already did it.
Yeah.
That means that it's no longer, we're not working hard not to lose. We're winning. We know we're winning because we already did it. That's the way we are talking about the goals. We have already done it.
We've already envisioned it also. So we started from a positive point itself, and that made it happen for us.
Yes. And if you can visualize that, if you start talking in pictures, what does winning mean for you? How does the world look like? You need to put the pictures into your brain because your brain is the chemist and your blood is the culture media. So when you take your arrival point, which you in your imagination already has reached, and you are now operating from there in reality, because you imagine the process. Can you follow what we're talking about here? Are you with me?
Definitely. Yes, got it.
So the part here is that If we define excellence at the single or individual level, bring goals to life by establishing what it looks like when the desired results are achieved. Define winning excellence as detailed as possible. That's what I'm talking about. And start picturizing that. Start. Mm-hmm. And how does it look like when we have achieved this goal? Think about the specific behaviors you want to see, the impact these behaviors will have, what really matters when choices have to be made, and how will employee make a decision on what to do and how to do it. If you already visualized that, if you already visualized that for the single employee, for the whole organization, then the winning. Can you follow what I'm saying? Good. If you have a business, what does winning look like for you? If you're focusing on your business, you have 10 employees, is that right?
Yes.
Good. So you're the CEO, you're the leader.
Right.
And you want, we have a speaker event going on end of March, that's right. What does that look like? What does that look like for you?
Yeah, that means a lot to us. It means we are leveraging into different network. It means we are meeting more people. It means we are sharing our vision of excellence with the people who are attending and participating in the event. For business itself, it's a new level. So we are leveling up. We've already envisioned a win through it.
Good, but you're not speaking past tense. We have 200 people attended this event. They enjoyed the day. There was these and these people. We had a lot of fun. We had those speakers. They made an impact, a very awesome impact. All the people attending signed up for most of the courses from or programs from these speakers. Can you follow what I'm doing now? I'm speaking past tense now.
That's one of the pictures already happened.
Yes, it already had happened. And I have the pictures of me, because I'm one of the speakers. I have the pictures of me in my head, standing on the stage, embracing people. People are laughing. They had so much fun. They are coming after, they came after the event and said, wow, this is amazing stuff. We never heard that, but it was so simple when you explained it. So this is the way we need to do this. We need to put the pictures in of our way. Yeah. It doesn't matter if you have a lots organization. It doesn't matter if you have a 10 people company. You need to have the pictures of your win. You need to have seen the event, and you need to describe it in the past tense so your employees understand how it looks like. Where do you want to be in 6 months in your business? What's going on in your business in 6 months?
I'm going to expand the team, and I'm working Good. On it already. Yes, so from 10, we are going to be somewhere around 20, inshallah. And now looking at good numbers. Yes.
Yeah, so you need to use the language. You're not using the language. You need to...
Okay, I have to use past tense.
Yes, you need to use past tense. And that's difficult. But in the moment you do it, it becomes, oh, we are already 20 people.
Yeah. So and you already seen those we are 20 people.
Yes, and you already seen those 20 people. And you may not have space for them now, but you are. If you need to move, you're already visualizing your company with the seats of 20 people.
Yeah.
You have those people, and your employees, your the people in the 10 people right now have those pictures. They have already an imagination of what is the world looking like 6 months from now. We are 20 more people. And that's how that's the win they are operating from, because you need to communicate that to your employees. They need to have the same picture as you have.
All right, they have to envision it.
Yes. That's how the elite in the world works. That's how sports people are working.
Right.
They have already the pictures from the future. Either maybe you can say, you found a picture on Google, you put it up in front of you, you're looking at it. That's how the future looks like in 6 months, and that's what you're looking at every single day. How would that impact you?
When I'm targeting something, I'm envisioning it all the time, seriously. And that has been my habit. Because I cannot stop myself until I have achieved what I want to achieve. So I keep on planning, envisioning, I'm picturing it in my head how it goes.
Yes, so but it's not you alone. You need to communicate your pictures to your employees. You need to visualize it. You need to have a PowerPoint presentation. This is how the future looks like in 6 months, boys and girls. This is how things are. If I'm an entrepreneur, I want to start a business.
Yes.
In some area. I need to have the pictures of how it looks like in 3 months. First of all, I need to do the goal mapping. I need to have my main goal, my main driver, my sub goals. I need to put in the emotions. I need to put in the emotions into the why. Why am I doing that? Why am I building my business? Why? Right. And since I'm emotional driven, I need to tap into emotions. I need to visualize, like you said,
it's very important for the entire team to go back to the goals every now and then, and to go back to the purpose itself every now and then, and keep on repeating it to themselves so that they remain focused.
What I said in the, before was that we have brain bubbles, and we need to burst the bubbles. Because okay. we are very good at proving ourselves right. But if we are proving ourselves right on the wrong data, we got a problem. We're not hitting the target. Can you follow what
Is
I'm saying?
Is it the responsibility of the leaders to tap into the right data and help the team also to tap into the right data?
Yeah, the point is that as a leader, you may not have the answers. That's what I told before when we followed the ladder. As a leader, you have assumptions. You have added meanings to things. You have conclusions. You have beliefs. Right. You have taking actions based on your beliefs. But if you do not, first of all, you need to know how the brain works and you need to suspend the process. You need to ask the questions, am I wrong? There is something else. It could be interpreted another way. There is more I know, do not know, or things has changed. Who can help you here? Who can help you here? Your employees. They are working with the clients and the customers and everything. They are working with stakeholders. So they know what's going on. You may not know that in the detail. So you need to interact. It's just like the boss coming into the meeting room and saying, we need to go this way. I know it. This is the challenge. This is the way. Is that the way to do things?
No.
What happens when you do that? What happens when you do that?
You block other people's contributions towards a sense of direction and many, many different ideas that could be invited at this point in time. They just wash away.
So there is a possibility
that if you are pointing towards only a single direction, then you're not letting other people contribute their sense of what the right direction should be. There are chances that you are perhaps going the wrong way. So it's important for the leader himself to get input from the team as well and come to a common sense of direction that is not just from one person's perception. What do you say about this?
You said block. I can add blind spots. I can add beliefs. Because if we do not stop, pause, first of all, burst our own bubbles and start listening, nothing is going to happen. And we will absolutely fail. If I go into my team meeting and say, we have some challenges and we have some goals, what do you think about it? What if? And then I keep quiet.
In that way, you're inviting flow of ideas that will not be there if you don't do this.
What you actually do is you're opening up for people's head. You're opening up for people to be creative. You're opening up for people to take responsibility. You're opening up for flexibility. You're opening up for empowerment. That's what you do. If you continue the way, we need to go this way, I'm the boss. And then when you have done that 2-3 times, what happens? People are not even opening their mouths anymore. People are not even listening anymore. They don't need their brain.
They're not even excited. They're not even excited to be on the same journey with you.
They are just robots. Yeah. You have decided everything up front. They are just getting the message and they just need to do an order. But in the moment you invite people in and you ask for their contribution, and that's where we can say, is it the egg which came first or is it the chicken which came first? Because there's two sides of this story. People may be used to you making the direction. So they're never ever saying anything. They're not even using their brain. So they're not opening up. So it's a process, you know. So you need to change and employees need to change. Both sides need to change.
Yes.
But you need to start somewhere. Mm-hmm. The employees needs to contribute and you need to burst your bubble as the leader manager.
Yes.
So
you can... We have a comment from someone. One minute.
Yeah.
It's a very relevant one. Server Muxi says, but there are people who are going through that situation. Boss walking in and saying, these are the goals and here is the way. And I guess what he wants to say is everybody has to follow what the boss says.
Yes, but then what happens when you always have to follow what the boss is saying? Are you happy and satisfied? Are you happy as an employee and satisfied as an employee? Are you having well-being? Are you having diversity? Are you having inclusion?
I will not enjoy my work if this is the way.
No, you will die. Is that right?
Yes.
You'll not only die. I know you, so you're not going to die. You'll just find another job.
Yeah, I will quit and do something else.
Yes. So what can we do as an employee? We can either say, fine, I don't need my head, the money is good, I'm going to stay. Or we can say, this is not for me, because actually I am dying. And the money may be good, but this is not my driver. I'm going for another job. Or we may say, boss, you know what? We think that this is the wrong way. You're focusing on the wrong data. This will only bring failure, which you did to your boss and she fired you. So this is, but it's up to us. It's the reason for me not being an employee. That's why I'm not an employee, and probably also why you're not an employee. So there is a risk combined with this if there's no understanding. But if you're looking at the trending, in the world, things are actually starting changing.
Yes.
We become more aware, not necessarily of the brain. That's one of my, you can say, problems, is that you may not know what I'm talking about, or you are not interested in listening to what I'm talking about. You may have a view of your employees as a cost, and you're not going to develop them, and you may evaluate that if they disappear, you can just find others. That may be one, but then you are actually out of business. If we are looking at great companies, like if you're looking at Pan Am, you're looking at Blockbuster Video, you're looking at Sears in the US, you're looking at, if we want to see something, BlackBerry, you're looking at Nokia, they may have that conclusion. But are they out of the market? Are they out of the market? Is BlackBerry out of the marketplace? Is Nokia out of the marketplace? Is video? 5-10 years ago, I think, or more, we were going down to shops and renting videos. Mm-hmm. Now Netflix is on demand.
Yes.
So Blockbuster died because they didn't follow. Netflix took all over the market.
Yeah.
And that's happening with people who are out of date. You can say that if you're looking into companies, we will see that an average lifespan of a Fortune 500 company in the 60s, 1960, was 60 years. Today, it's more than 20. It's less than 20. The lifespan for a company. If they're not renewing and following the trends in the market and opening up and having the right data and ERP, digitalization of all their data, then they are falling out of the market because they don't have the right tools. If you don't, looking at your business, if you don't follow the trends, if you're stuck in the past, you're stuck.
No, and I'm not going to survive. Seriously, next year I will shut down then.
And if you're stuck, you'll shut down. Is that right?
Exactly. Yes.
Yes. So you can say that if you're living in the old models of business, you'll die. It comes by itself.
Exactly.
Clients, customers are just disappearing.
Yes.
If
innovation, you can say, adaptability, flexibility, we come back to the same thing again.
Yes.
And being adaptable and flexible consistently is something that saves companies from becoming obsolete.
Yes. What I'm bringing to the marketplace is, first of all, you need to raise awareness of how the brain is working. That's one thing.
Yeah.
If you know how the brain is working, like the ladder of inference, like bursting brain bubbles, and like understand the basics of your brain, understand the basic of the epicenter of performance, and starting unlearning, grow your self-awareness. And the other part is that what I have learned the hard way was to stay positive, to stay focused, to be flexible. What I do today, I may dump tomorrow because it may not work because the outer world changed. I need to be proactive and I absolutely need to be organized.
Yes.
Those are areas I need to focus on all the time. The more positive I stay, if I have this perspective, I need to work hard not to lose. Is that a positive statement?
No. No, because your focus is on saving yourself from losing rather than being active in winning. There is a difference. Come on.
So I'm barely surviving. How many people do you think I need to work hard not to lose? How many people do you think in the world has that perception?
I think a lot of people have been into this thing for quite some time till they realize that just saving yourself and surviving is not actually the thing you should be after. But too many people are at that stage and at that realization.
That's how people are seeing every single morning. They wake up, the alarm clock is buzzing, and they wake up. I need to work hard not to lose today.
Yeah.
If people look at life that way, I need to work hard today not to lose my job. I need to work hard today not to lose my client. I need to work hard today to get. If that's the perception, then you're working from a negative mindset.
Exactly.
And you're in stress.
So, one comment is here. Like when we're talking about all this, Server Maxi says you cannot quit because finding the job in this situation, come on, sir. He means that it's difficult. So, you know, Server Maxi, you have exactly said what we are talking about. So if you're going to do things just because you want to save yourself and be on the survival mode, you're on the wrong side of what you should be doing.
So I need to, how do I find a job in this situation? There is no jobs. Every time I send out my CV, I do never hear from people. So I'm not going to do that anymore. It's just a waste of time. I'm just sitting at home looking into the wall. Is that the way to do it? No. I need to find my passion. In the moment I find my passion, and that's one of the workshops we got, I need to find my goals. Because when I found what is it the job I really want, what is the job which is making my life incredible, what is the job which is making life awesome, what is the job where I wake up in the morning, wow, I'm going to work today, I'm going to do amazing today. What is that job? Where's your passion? That's one of the things you need to focus on. The next part, how do I get that job? That's goal mapping. I want this job. What is the things that I need to do? So what is the sub goals? This is my main goal. This is my passion. This is the job I want. This is where I'm doing amazing. This is where I'm incredible. What is the sub goals? How do you get there? When are you getting there? First of all, you need to see yourself in this position. See yourself doing this. Then you're starting energizing your body. What happens when you're energizing your body? You attract. Is that right?
Yes.
Great.
Yes,
so if you start visualizing this, you're seeing yourself sitting there, you're seeing yourself doing this, you're seeing yourself acting with clients, you're seeing yourself doing awesome and amazing. And then you start, what happens when you do that? You get salary, you get love, you get, you're now putting in the emotions of that. Mm. What are you doing now? You're energizing yourself. You are now starting shining. You're not giving yourself the power to actually make the right CV or engage with somebody who can make the CV. Going out, knocking doors, picking up the phone and talking to people, engaging with people. Yes. Now you make the timeline. When do you have this? What actions do you need to do? That's what I. What action is needed to you to get the dream job? What do you need? Actions. Who can help you? Nousheen can help you. Flemming can help you. Who can help you? Who do you know? Can you go for LinkedIn? Do you know anybody there? Who can spread the word? This is your passion. This is what you want. Yes. Can you go for it? Can you go, wow, this company, I just go for the reception. I want to talk to the HR director. Can you do that? What happens when
Let me tell a story. In 2000, after the recession of 2008, my husband was looking for a job and he came to Dubai looking for a job.
Yes.
He spent a week in sending applications by the internet. And he was not getting any responses at all from any HR in the industry. He's into wealth management. He was not receiving anything at all. So what he did was exactly what you were telling. He picked up the phone and he started calling the HR to find out what's happening. And then he physically went to offices.
Yes.
And he spoke with HR. He asked reception to make sure that he speaks with HR. It wasn't easy.
No.
The market was down. The jobs were not there at all. People were not giving or promising salaries at that time. That was just post-2008 recession. But within one month's time, he nailed it. And he got job in one of the best organizations in Dubai. He got it.
Yes, the part is here that when you do that in your imagination and you talk like you already have the job.
Yeah.
Your brain can't recognize between imagination and reality. Exactly. Then you act like you already have the job. It's different to go for a job interview as you already were sitting having the job. And having the confidence, and you're just seeking new, you can say new, what do we call it? Yeah, you're just seeking new, what do we call it? It doesn't matter. You have already this job, and you already have it in your head, and it's already imagined. Now you go for a job interview. You have nothing to lose anymore. You already got the job. They need to put up something that makes you want to change. Can you follow? From one dream job to a reality job. Is that a totally different way?
When you have the right dream in your head and you're living it, you're able to transform it into reality because you will attract. But if you will sit there and think, okay, I don't know why this is not happening, and why that is not happening, and I'm not understanding why this is not happening, and nobody is understanding me at all, it's not going to happen for you at all.
You're moving from two different ways. You're moving from work hard not to lose. That's a loser mindset. That's a victimizing. That's a victim. And if you already have visualized the win, if you're always speaking of this like it already happened, like past tense, you're moving with the mindset of a conqueror. You're moving with the mindset of a winner. Is that right or wrong? You can correct me.
You're right. You're absolutely right.
And do you want to hire a loser?
No. Come
Do you want to hire?
I want to hire someone with a very positive mindset, someone who is ambitious, someone who is very clear about what he's going to do in next 5 years, someone who is proactive and gets up in the morning and has already an agenda on his head, is driven, motivated, focused. And yes, he continues
that's, with the same energy. But that's a winner. That's a winner. And everybody is a winner. It's all about which navigator, which perception, which comfort zone are you moving from?
When I work with such a person, we will have a combined high energy level. And we will be exchanging the same every day. And we will both be motivated to win. Because we come from there.
So actually what we're talking about here is motivated people, motivate people. Is that right?
Exactly.
negative people is just dragging everything down.
Yeah, I will not come to office then.
No, complaining people is just putting everything down. So if I, as the organization, have the right data, the ERP, the digitalization, all, I got that. I have the strategic department. We start focusing together, it could be with employees. What is the win of this organization? How does the environment look like in many different areas? We're having dragging in employees, we're getting opinions there, we make the strategies. Then we actually need to set up and visualize the win. And we need to talk about it like we already did it.
Yes.
This is how the elite in the world is working. And what we have now concluded by the questions I asked you, and I can even ask the audience, you do not want to hire a loser. You do not want to hire a person who is very negative. You want to hire a winner. You want to hire somebody who is in peak performance. To be in peak performance, I need to have the right biochemicals released in my body. I need to have the right pictures to do that because my emotions is releasing the biochemicals, the electric signals in my body. So I need to visualize the win. So every single individual understand how it looks like.
Yes. Absolutely.
And this is why we are talking about the brain as the chemist. Because this is the 3 pounds you're carrying around every single day, and it can lead you to disaster, or it can lead you to awaysom, significance. It's all about how you use it.
Exactly.
And if you know that as a leader, if you know that in your business, if you know how to energize your body, you also know how to energize everybody else's body. If you know about the 4 behavioral styles, the excellence, the action, the harmony, the reasoning, and everybody is needed on a team, if we're looking into the team. I can't work my team without data. So I need a guy to analyze the data, to understand the data. But he may bring me a report of 1,000 pages, which I will die reading because I'm an action guy. So he knows, of course, that he needs to make a summary of 2 pages and then I'll say approved.
Yes.
That's why we're not knowing each other.
Understanding.
Understanding each other.
Everybody works. Yes.
Yeah, by understanding each other, understanding how we are wired, you can say so. This is a 2,000 years old research where we are combined to the 4 elements. I'm connected to the 4 elements. I know how that works. I can choose if I want to be excellence, action, harmony, or reasoning. That's my choice because I'm well aware of that. But if I'm not well aware of that, I will not be able to choose.
Mm.
And if I'm not able to choose, I'm miscommunicating.
Exactly. And everything is a mess then.
And everything is a mess, yes. And people will fail because this is the way I'm setting them up.
Mm. Yeah.
So this is, and there's much more, but this is the fundamentals of actually I would say the fundamentals is the ladder of inference. Google it if you want to know more, or connect with me. But in the moment, you actually understand the ladder of interference, then life becomes a lot easier.
It does.
This is how your brain works. This is how your brain makes decisions.
True. Absolutely true.
So, did we get any questions?
Yes, I'm waiting for you guys to ask us any questions about how to win. If you still not understood it.
Tell me if you don't
ask us now.
So everybody knows how to win. That's why they're not asking questions. So everybody is simply
Everybody is a winner. The best part is today, everybody is a winner, and they've completely got it. That's why there is no question.
Yes, they must be winners. They must be conquerors. They must be, you know, away some total significant every single day. Otherwise, they would ask questions.
Of course, yes. So true.
And so this very, very intelligent audience we have.
Absolutely true. Yes. So what are we going to discuss in the coming episode next? Give me one second.
What do you think? One of the things I would like to talk a little bit about.
There we go.
Innovation or what? What do you think? I can't hear you. Either my connection is pretty bad or your connection is bad. Resilience? Because that's actually needed. Can you hear me? Can you hear me? Hello? Because I can't hear you, Nousheen. My internet connection is good. I didn't hear you for about a minute. What did you say?
One second, please. I'm fixing things up.
Hello?
Now, can you hear and see me?
No, you're totally clear.
Yeah, it's okay now. All right. Every day something happens and some screen freezes and then it has to be. All right. So what I was saying was that in the coming week, we are going to talk about thinking differently and why it's important for everybody to think differently and be ready for innovation. You know, many people think that it's not possible for every person to be innovative. And I don't agree with this.
It's not what?
Many people think that not everybody can be innovative. Only a few selected people can be innovative. You think that's true?
That's totally wrong. Life is infinite. Your current result is not a representation of your potential, only your current level of awareness of your potential.
Why?
We humans are pattern-seeking, structured, loving beings. Get shocked, or who's typically unexpected change. We go through, you could say, many different phases: shock, denial, frustration, anger, depression, or lack of energy, and so on. So there's a lot of things happening in our brain, and that's actually what we need to understand. But one of the things we could talk about was resilience and innovation. Every single individual can be innovative. every single individual can be creative. We were 98% creative when we were born.
Yeah.
Yes. As an adult, we only have 2% left. And that's actually where I want to bring our attention. Why is that? How come? Why is that we only have 2% left as an adult? How come we were that creative as kids? What's going on? And actually, I would. How come? Are we getting lazy? What is the reason for us being only having, according to surveys, according to international investigations, we only got 2% in creativity, innovation as adults? Is it what the question was? We only had one question today. Is it because we got managers, leaders who tells us what to do? Who tells us what to do all the time? So which means we don't need to use the brain.
Right.
Is that the reason? What is that? Could you make a survey of this? A couple of surveys.
Yes, we will post a poll today for everybody in Flemming's LinkedIn. There will be a poll today in Flemming's LinkedIn today that will talk about what are the reasons you are not being innovative enough. And the first will be, is the leadership not encouraging you to be innovative? Is it because you are not willing to experiment and find out the answers? And please do answer the poll, because that is very relevant to what we are going to talk about next week.
Absolutely. So why is it that we are not innovative? Why is it that we are not creative as adults?
Yeah.
That would be great. That I would really appreciate that. A couple of polls in that area. So we have, you can say, some kind of numbers. I love numbers. What we are doing now is actually just collecting data.
Yeah, exactly. So that we can talk about it.
Yes. So we can actually focus on this next week.
Yes.
Wonderful. Super. Thank you for being here. And
you,
I'm so happy that everybody is a winner. They didn't need to ask questions. Sorry, maybe a little.
Mohammed Idris is here. I think he just joined us now. And he says, always works for win-win situation. Positive thinking, yes.
Yes.
Positive
yes.
thinking does it. No doubt.
That's it. That's it. And the part I learned is the more questions I asked, the more intelligent I become. And the more data I collect, and the more data I collect, the less I'm making the wrong decisions.
Absolutely.
And the more my beliefs are starting changing, and the more my assumptions are starting changing, and my conclusion would become different.
Okay, great.
Wonderful. Thank you for today, everybody. Wonderful to
see you next week.
See you next week.
Yeah, see you next week. Take care, everybody. We are ending the podcast now, and we are waiting for you to answer our poll as soon as we post it. And then you should be joining us next week and participating in the conversation. Keep your questions ready. We know you are a winner, but we want to know whether you are innovative or you are not being innovative, or whether somebody is snubbing you from being innovative.
Yes.
Okay, bye-bye for now. Have a good day.
Have a good day.